It was a family home like any other, full of laughter, joy and good times. And yodeling. Please welcome two women who were born to entertain, mother and daughter Mary and Melinda Schneider. Mary, I'm going to start with you, but chip in wherever you want, Melinda. Okay. Let's get to the technicalities first. What is yodeling?
It's a break from your chest to your head voice, like, and you're just with rapidly doing that. And it's a technique. That's what it is.
You see, I think I can do this.
You can? Mm.
Yeah, yeah.
That's it.
That's it?
You've
got it.
No, well, you can go now. I've got it covered.
You come and sit here.
Yeah. Can anyone be trained to yodel? Could you take my raw, shining talent and really make it special?
Make it better.
Mm, well, not.
You've already got the break there.
Yeah, so, I know. That comes from some childhood accidents. I can't.
No, if you've already got the break, then you make it a little bit stronger and stronger and be able to go, fast, you know, like that. After a while.
Go on, Andrew.
A little bit of work.
What she said. Yeah. I can't do that.
I got a good idea.
Well, yeah,
you practice on a Tarzan sort of sound.
Yeah.
Oh, I see.
Like he went, oh, like that.
Yeah.
If you do that in the bathroom a few times every day.
Yes.
So when you're sober.
Now, we've got a bit of music here. We've got a bit of William Tell Overture. Are you happy to give us a burst?
Just a little bit, yeah.
A little bit of a burst?
Okay. Hi ho, Silver. You got it.
I want you to be my phone answering machine. That's fantastic. Because both of you are trained yodelers. Can you describe to me what for you is the beauty of yodeling?
It can be very beautiful. I think the way Mum does it is beautiful. It can be also dreadful if it's not in tune.
How do you know when a yodel's gone wrong?
You know, you just know.
You know, just not good on the ears.
But we do lots of harmony, you know, over the years we've done harmony
yodeling.
I like
that clarinet polka.
Yeah.
Can you do a bit of that? Yeah.
What do we do?
What we rehearsed?
Oh, okay. Oh, 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 that'll do.
Okay.
Oh, dee, oh, do, 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 do,
I'm guessing that you could never pretend you didn't hear your mum call you from the other end of the house. Never get away with that one, right?
The next neighbourhood, I think.
I'm going to talk a bit about your childhood later, but I want to go back to the roots of your career, Mary, because they're extraordinary. You came from a very musical family and you and your sister Rita toured as the Schneider sisters.
Yeah, for many years.
What kind of act was it?
It was an instrumental vocal act. We played banjo, guitar, accordion, a bit of piano and a Schneider phone, which was a homemade musical instrument my brother built, and we invented that idea. And we call it the Schneider phone because it's Schneider one thing or the other.
Boom, boom. Boom, boom.
We got a little bit of footage here of from you back in the 1950s, I think it is, or might be early 60s, of the Schneider sisters 60s. In full fly.
Thank you.
Wow. Hell of a voice. Everywhere you went were there Schneider phones appearing and...
No. No, I haven't seen any other Schneider phones.
Well, it is unique and we have your Schneider phone here. Al, can we bring in the Schneider phone, which is something I rarely get to say on the show. It's an extraordinary instrument. You and Rita designed it, is that right?
Yes.
Can you talk us through it? What have you got here?
It's all those horns are all tuned up. Oh, God, cut it. I've got to play it.
Yeah, give it.
Oh, come on. Yeah, we've got it. There's only one in the world.
Can I do it there?
Yeah.
Just in that position. Wait a minute. I've got to get my thimbles first. You use
props.
Thimbles.
Get your props.
You've got to get that. Oh, I can't play without thimbles.
Oh, I see.
Okay, so it goes... like that.
That's fantastic. I mean, that's a serious piece of design. Where did you get the idea? How long did it take you to work it out?
Oh, well, there was an act years ago called the Hoosier Hotshots, years ago, way long time ago. We used to listen to them on radio and they had a little sort of a honkophone thing or something they played, hanging it on themselves, and we just thought to do it that way with all these clacks and horns like... and all that, those effects.
Will I go to a museum eventually, do you think? Mary, or stay in the family?
Don't know.
Well, it's a beautiful thing.
To anybody.
You're not
keeping
it. You and Rita split up in the early 70s and you were interested in other forms of music, opera and blues and jazz, but you decided to stay with the yodeling. Why was that?
Well, I always yodeled when I was a little girl, sitting up in the mango tree going, yodel-o-doo, you know, every morning and afternoon. And I could always yodel, but then when I was in my teens, I thought, so uncool to yodel. No, I was really into jazz and all that. I still love jazz.
Yeah.
I was into all that.
You're a great jazz singer. Not many people know that about Mum, and I'm at her all the time to do a jazz. Dad used to say, man, do a straight album. And I'm always at her to do this album. In fact, we've written a song together called No Yodeling Here.
Oh.
And I want it to be the title track.
No yodeling here.
Yeah.
Go on.
No, we're just writing it.
What is it? You can sing, I can scat, render Ella on that. I want to make it clear that I've made up my mind that I'm going to be kind, so there ain't no yodeling here.
Why don't you do that?
No.
We've half written the song, I said, Anyway.
You've had an extraordinarily successful career doing yodeling, but you've got this other love as well. And I know opera's been one of your loves.
I love the classics, I love jazz, I love all music. But that magic of yodeling came out in the 80s, so it went golden platinum, you know. Nobody would believe that it was going to be anywhere. Went round to all the record companies, they said, no.
She's got rejection letters from everybody.
Yeah, I do.
And Melinda, for you, I've read you said that you had a bit of a weird upbringing. In what way weird?
Policeman dad, yodeling mum. Mm-hmm. Kind of, lots of therapy.
When he turned the siren on, did Mary yodel? Was there?
He arrested her if she wouldn't. It was an unusual childhood, but a very happy one. Mm. I was an only child.
Yeah.
I am an only child, and you know, very close family. Dad was a great dad, very supportive of Mum. He used to joke that he moonlit as a cop. He was her roadie for 40 years.
So it was always musical?
Yeah, very musical.
And did Keith, your dad, was he musical as well, or he just enjoyed the music?
He could sing. He was a bit of a crooner.
Because he used the roadie thing as a way of getting to know you, didn't he?
Dad told me that he went out one night with his mates and he saw Mum and Rita on stage. He saw Mum's legs and said, "That's for me." That was it.
Wow, isn't that fantastic?
Yeah.
Did you go touring with your Mum? Did you go to the venues?
Mum didn't tour a lot for long periods. She was a very good Mum in that respect. She kept me in one school.
She tells me.
Do you want the back? She was really, you know, I had a very sort of stable upbringing in that way. And But I did go to a lot of shows and I would fall asleep under Mum's fur coat backstage.
Well, I had it later, an only child, and I didn't want to farm her out to somebody while I did a gig and farm her out somewhere else, so we took her with us.
Yeah.
And you learned quite a lot of musical instruments when you were young, is that right?
Yeah, I think ukulele was the first instrument Mum ever taught me when I was about three.
When you were three?
Yeah.
We've got the uke here, as we musicians like to call it. Yeah. So what would you play on the ukulele when you were a kid?
Well, the first song that Mum ever taught me was The Way We Were.
On the ukulele?
Yeah.
And it was I remember it being a really sad song for me, and I used to cry sometimes when I would sing it.
Even as a little kid?
Yeah, I really used to get into the emotion of it. I can't believe I'm playing a ukulele on Denton. Okay, so it was same key as when I was four too, by the way.
Memories like the corners of my mind, misty watercolored memories of the way.
Before those TV commercials.
Yeah, the phone home ones. When you hear that, Mary, do you just see the little girl in your living room?
Yes, I see her.
Yeah. Yeah.
She was good at harmonising too. When I used to sing her to sleep when she was little, I'd sing, "Sleep, my darling, good night, da-da-dee-da," and pat her off to sleep and she'd go, "Sleep, my darling, good night." She'd do the harmony with me. I said, "I'm singing you to sleep, you're not singing."
When you were about eight, you recorded a song with Mary, "I Just Want to Yodel Like You." How did that go?
At the time, it was a good idea at the time.
Yeah.
Did it and it was all good, you know. But people took it literally.
Oh, really?
Mum's fans.
What, that you were the anointed?
That I really did want to yodel like Mum.
Oh, right, yeah.
A lot of people over the years, especially when I was 8 and 9 and 10, used to come up to me after the show and I'd do a couple of songs in Mum's act and stuff and they'd say, "You're not as good as your mother."
Oh, give
or, you know,
way.
"You'll never be as good as your mother." And I'd go, "I'm 8. You know?
Funny,
but it did affect me. You know, I didn't like being compared. I wanted to do what I did and I didn't really enjoy that part of it.
Well, it's tough though when you're that age, particularly when you get into adolescence where you're trying to find your own identity. Here's your mum with this towering career and this love of music which you're surrounded by. Mm. Very difficult, I would have thought, to feel yourself constantly compared.
Yeah, it wasn't much fun. And I think it's hard to, as a child of someone, an entertainer, and be successful at it. It's a very tough thing to do.
When you're about 16, you had another enormous hit with that Yodeling the Classics. The story behind how this came about is quite remarkable. How did this come to you?
Well, I dreamt that idea. Do you know that? I was walking down this staircase in this dream with a beautiful gown on, and I was a soprano and I'd done a lot of training through my life and I was singing these operatic arias, but I wasn't singing them, I was yodeling them. And I woke up and I said to Keith, "I had a strange dream, you know, I was yodeling these operatic." He said, "What?" And you know, I couldn't let that go until I did it.
We have some footage here of you performing in Hanover in Germany. Mm-hmm. How was that time for you when everything was going off in Europe?
Wonderful, wonderful. That show was hosted by Supriti Ustinov and Jose Carreras was in that show and Charlotte Church, a lot of wonderful artists in that show. And I thought, I wonder how this is going to be. It's a 72-piece orchestra. I wonder if they're in Germany, you know. I wonder how they're going to think of me going... Mm. you know, and doing that, and I loved it. You know, I've done quite a bit of that in Germany, Europe, at the Berlin Opera House. I worked and I jumped out of a cake there.
You jumped out of a cake?
Yeah.
Why?
Yodeling.
Yodeling. What was the occasion?
Fully clothed, Andrew.
Yeah. It was the Deutsche Academy Awards.
You jumped out of a cake
and a
yodeling.
Gold dress, and everything was gold. And they made a cake for me, and I had to go, yodi, 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 or something like that.
That's better than Marilyn Monroe singing Happy Birthday, Mr. President.
Yeah,
that's good.
Yeah, I reckon.
Is there a tension for you that some people see you as a novelty act, don't they?
Oh, yeah.
How do you deal with that?
Well, they've got to understand that it's a technique and it's quite an art form, yodeling.
Does it irritate you?
Well, I didn't want to talk about this.
Well, we were on Howard Stern in New York, yeah. And that was pretty brutal. And it was my idea to get Mum on the show. And, you know, I said to Mum, look, if he says anything at all about sex, just say, yes, Howard, I yodel at all times. And she did, and
so
we loved it.
He says, you know, your daughter's pretty hot. He says, tell me, do you yodel during sexual activity? I said, oh, God, what am I going to say? I said, yes, I yodel at all times. And he said,
He loved her. Yeah. He loved her.
All you got to do is agree with him because, you know, well, what else do you say? That's what he was
just
about.
Just be honest, Mum.
Quiet.
Did Melinda go through the teenage rebellion?
No.
In her 20s?
Maybe
I think she's doing it now. It's all a bit late. No, she can do what she likes. Do what she likes.
Because the mother-daughter thing is always, it's a complicated relationship, isn't it?
Mm.
And I imagine, Melinda, for you, that you had to travel a long way musically to find the sound that was right for you. Would that be correct?
Yeah, it took me quite a long time. I didn't record my first record till I was 28. That's old in the pop world. Luckily, it was a country record. But, it took me a long time to figure out.
What about Tighten Up
Your Pants? Yeah, well, there was only one single in that, techno yodeling song.
Yeah. Well, Tighten Up Your Pants, this is Audio Murphy. This is when you're about 23. Mm. I think this is pretty cool. I tried to get this off iTunes. They're not selling it. You've got to talk to them about it. This is Tighten Up Your Pants. That's great voice. What was the thinking there, techno yodeling? Was that the future, did you think?
There was only one single in that, Andrew. I had the idea to marry yodeling and techno music, and coincidentally, Mark Moffat, the producer, called Mum and said, look, I've had this idea to yodel techno and to match, to marry yodeling and techno, and Mum said, so is my daughter. And, you know, she'd be really good for it. So Mum kind of put me on to him, and then we wrote the Square Dance rap thing, and Tighten Up Your Pants was born.
That is so extraordinary. There couldn't have been three people in Australia thinking of techno yodeling.
Kindred spirits.
That's amazing, isn't it?
And it got to number 5 on the dance charts. But even then, I was very, very wary of using my last name. I think it was Audio Murphy featuring Melinda. You know, I didn't want to be stereotyped and locked into being a yodeler because I knew that I would never lose it if I went there.
Is that partly from watching your mum's career, or was it just something you didn't want for yourself?
Yeah, it was because of watching mum's career. Once you do something like that, people want you to do it all the time, and it's very hard to break away. And
you get with yodeling, you see, you get in a box. They think that's all you do. People come and say to me, can you sing too? I said, thank you.
What a bizarre thing to say, but they do.
You know.
I want to come back to you in a second, Lynn, but I'm interested in what you just said then about you get stuck in a box.
You do.
Why haven't you gone with the other things that you can also do?
Oh, I don't know. Why haven't I? I don't know that.
Answer that? Because you don't think anyone is interested in you singing jazz, and I disagree.
Yeah. Because I was talking to Frank Ifield once and he said to me, I said, I'd love to do just a jazz record, just sing something, you know, nice ballads and good things and that. He said, they'll say, oh, we're not buying this, there's no yodeling on here, you know.
Does it matter if people buy it, though, isn't it?
No.
Isn't it to do the thing that's in your heart?
That's right, you're right.
If she doesn't do it, I will be really sad.
Mm.
If she doesn't do it before she...
goes.
Falls off the perch. I will.
Oh,
I will be
God.
Really sad.
Because I noticed, and I'm sorry to kind of break the confidence, but before, when I met you before the show and we talked about we're going to have the Schneider van out here, and I could feel your resistance. It was like, you know, I don't want to be that. Even though you understand and are proud of that as your history, I don't want to be that.
Oh, I don't know. I've enjoyed everything. I've enjoyed working with Rita. It was wonderful years.
I enjoyed the washboard,
and I still play it. It's a bit of a gimmicky thing. Yeah, I'm just an entertainer. I love people.
You could hear her sing, Mum does this song called The Cabin, which is a really sort of dark jazz piece. And it's my favourite thing that she does.
Mm.
She's got such a great voice just as a singer. I love the way she sings those serious songs.
Do you need a backing track to sing The Cabin?
No, we can't do that.
Sing a little bit.
No.
Come on.
No, please don't ask me to do that.
Do it.
No.
Yeah. Just a little bit.
The cabin was cosy and hollyhocks grew bright by the door till his whisper crept through. No, I can't do any more.
I love it.
No.
Beautiful.
See, we live in such a time now, Mary, where you can, if you so choose, record whatever you want and put it wherever you want to.
Mm. Just for your own sake.
Hmm. You never know what happens until you put it out there.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Let's talk about the first song that won a Golden Guitar for you, one of your four, which was the Story of My Life, which was a watershed moment. Tell me about that song and why it was special.
The Story of My Life came about, I don't know, I was just thinking about my life one day and I wrote the words. I was born in 71 to a policeman dad and a yodeling mum, but went on to surprise everyone by turning into a gardener. They were the first words I wrote for this song. I'm like, what? And I just dropped the gardening bit and, wrote the first verse. And it changed my life to look within and write such an honest song. I didn't know how it would be received. I thought, wow, it is all about me. I'm not sure how people are going to, whether they're going to like it that much. But it turned out that it was also all about them because we're just all the same.
Mm.
We all go through the same stuff.
What did you think the first time Melinda played it to you, Mary?
Oh, I cried. I cried. I did. We were in the car. So did Dad, didn't he? We were both... Oh, we were amazed because she's so good at writing now and getting better all the time. This new one she's got out now, it's just so beautiful. You know,
Thanks, wonderful songs.
I'm very... I love her dearly. I do love her dearly. I'm so lucky to have her.
Are you a good critic too, if Melinda does something which you don't... Oh, yeah?
Yeah, a little too.
Yeah.
But I'm not perfect. She's critical with me too. Nobody's perfect.
I'm a little more gentle on you.
See,
I think
what
I
do
am.
You do?
What does she say to you when something's not right?
She just comes straight out and says, no, don't like it. You know, she's pretty harsh.
No, I don't.
You are sometimes. You are.
Sorry. I don't mean to be, I'm just...
But it's okay because I just tell her now. You know, there would be years ago I wouldn't have said it. I would have just been hurt and not said it. And now I just say, that was a little insensitive. Maybe you should...
Oh, stop it. You're making me sound horrible.
Does she beat you with coat hangers as well, Melinda?
No way!
God. You know, I adore her.
The thing is, I'm the parent of an only child too, and is our focus not so intense on an only child? How important is it to you that Melinda succeeds, not in terms of sales, but she succeeds in her life?
Oh, it's very important that she gets what's in her, in her life. I want her to be happy. That's the main thing. Mm. I want her to be content and happy. And I'm so proud of what she does, but I want to get everything out of life. I'm sorry I'm saying all this because it sounds like I'm skiting about it, but she's beautiful inside, this little girl.
Mm.
And I feel like I've tried to guide her because I had her later in my life, and I used to spend a lot of time talking to her. I didn't say, oh, I'm in the kitchen, don't tell me. I'd just drop everything and go and have a good talk to her about things that happened at school or that. And I think that's terribly important, I think.
Melinda, I'd like to talk about one other song you wrote, which you performed to your dad just before he died.
Mm.
Can you tell me about that?
Yeah, Dad had cancer for 5 years, an emphysema. He was really sick, and Mum looked after him amazingly well. And a couple of months before he died, I woke up in the middle of the night and it was raining, and I just couldn't sleep. I was so sad. And went out into my lounge room, and this song just poured out of me. And it was called We'll Meet Again Someday. And I believe we will.
Mm.
And I knew that I would sing it at his funeral, but I didn't want to wait. Till then, I thought, why wait? So 2 days before he died, he was at home and he was sort of in a semi-coma, and I sang it to him. I said, Dad, I've got a song to sing you, and sang it to him. And it's a very brutal, brutally sad song. And he just took my hand and said, really nice, really nice. He just kept saying, really nice. So I was so glad that I could do that for him. Mm. And then I did the eulogy at his funeral and sang the song at the funeral as well. And
that must have been hard to sing.
Yeah, yeah, it was tough. But so glad that, you know, that I could. I wrote a song for Mum about losing Dad, and it's a really sad song, and heaps of women come up to me and say, I lost my husband, I know what your mum's going through, and they have a little cry after the show, and it's really amazing when you can touch people on that level, you know?
Now, it's a beautiful thing that Melinda would write a song for you about dealing with...
That was beautiful.
Yeah. How is life without Keith?
It's the hardest thing that's ever happened to me. I mean, just losing him. We were very, very close and happy. And I don't know, I still feel like I'm half here.
Mm.
Yeah, I do. I do, because I hate just not having by my side to hold my hand and all that. And it's very hard. Some people don't feel it as much. I don't know whether they do or not, but I mean, I'm just... I've got friends that say, oh, well, you'll get over it in time and all that, but it's hard. Mm. I'm not getting over it. I'm not getting over it. It's really very hard when you lose your best mate, your best mate.
Melinda, I want to show you a clip from Enough Rope of a transvestite called Sarah, who inspired you to write the song you're going to perform at the end of the show called Be Yourself.
The most important thing for everybody is to, as I used to say, and I said to Sam as well, be yourself. Everybody else is already taken.
I just loved the story of the living library.
Yeah.
And his or her story was a fascinating one. I loved the acceptance of his wife when she, you know, when he told her that he was a transvestite. And he'd been hiding it from her, and she said, I don't care what you do, just don't lie to me. And they stayed married, and, you know, he was able to do what he wanted to do. And you asked him, you know, if there was anyone out there going through what you went through, what would you say to them? And he said, be yourself, everybody else is taken. And it hit me like a ton of bricks, because it was exactly what I was going through at that very time, coming out of my divorce and getting back to my old self again. And I just loved it.
Before we go, Mary, when are you bringing out the jazz album? You've had time to think about it.
There you go.
complete approval from a whole audience.
Would you buy it? Is that a promise?
Hang on, okay. We're not pushing a deal here. I can see you're very proud of each other and with reason. Thank you both very much.
Thank you.
Thanks, Andrew. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Everybody else is taking, and no one else can do the things you do. Let your heart write the music that you're making. You be you. Everybody else is taking. Expensive high. Diamonds and gold, brand new bodies that never grow old. Bigger houses, bigger cars, they are the Joneses. You're who you are, be yourself. Everybody else is taking, and no one else do the things you do. Let your heart write the music that you're making. You be you. Everybody else is taking. You wanna fly like the birds. Take your life story and change the world. Something greener on the other side. But hey, there's something you haven't tried. Be yourself. Everybody else is taking, and no one else can do the things you do. Let your heart write the music that you're making. Everybody else is